Hello, welcome to the Checkpoint this week. I am Vivian Kamsini. Now we are checking on Israel and the Gaza war. What is happening there? We have also heard from the news coming there where the Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, has turned down voices that have been calling for ceasefire and saying this is a time for war. What does that mean? There seems to be no end to what is happening now. With me is retired Major David Rusa, who is an international scholar, and he's going to be telling us and explaining to us what is happening in the Israel-Gaza war. How are you?
Oh, Vivian, good. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. You are an international scholar.
Yes.
And currently, the Prime Minister of Israel is saying this is a time for war. And he has turned down voices that have been saying, can there be a ceasefire? And the U.S. has actually backed him up that there should be no ceasefire. Why?
Well, I don't know. I don't know when it has never been time for war in the Middle East. I always believe in looking at the background of this story or any other story.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the Middle Eastern story is as old as history. We all have the most common book, the Bible. It talks about all the wars that were fought in that land. Now, the Quran, I'm sure, also talks about various conflicts in that region. Now, to begin with, this war, as I said, is as old as time because each of these people, Palestinians and Jews, believe they have every right to be in that area. Each of them believes to be the natives of that area. And, well, the reason is not hard to find. In the Bible, Abraham produced two children, two sons at least. His wife Sarah delayed to produce, and he produced a son with his slave woman or maid, with his maid, called Hagar. And that son is called either Ishmael, if you are an Arab speaker, or Ishmael, if you are a Hebrew speaker, but the same name. And then after Hagar had given birth to Ishmael, then Sarah conceived, according to the Bible, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And she gave birth to Isaac. Now these two brothers, or half-brothers according to Western terminology, are the ancestors of the Arabs and the Jews. The Arabs are descendants of Ishmael or Ishmael, and the Jews are descendants of Isaac. And these two constitute a group, a race of people called Semites. They are the only two major ones. The others, I think, died off. There was Aramaic, I don't think they are there. But the two major Semitic tribes left now are the Israelis, or the Jews, and the Arabs. Now, the Semites, if you go a bit far backwards, are descended from Noah's son called Shem. Semites. Well, Shem is the ancestor of the Semites. And then there are also descendants of Ham, called Hamites, and so on and so forth. I don't want to go into that bit of story. Suffice it to say that these two groups of people, in spite of having that close blood affinity, have been at war since time immemorial. In the Bible, we see the wars where the Jews were taken into Babylon exile. And Babylon now is what is called Iraq today. So the Jews were always being, at one time they were in Egypt as slaves. Then they were freed from there. They entered the promised land of Canaan with Moses, who did not enter, unfortunately, but Joshua led. And then later on, they were conquered and taken into exile in Babylon. In the olden days, apparently, when you were defeated and conquered, then you'd be shifted even from your territory. And that's how the Jews came to be in Babylon during the time of Nebuchadnezzar. When you read the book of Daniel in the Bible, all these things are recorded. Fortunately for the history of the Jews, you don't have to go any further. It's all in the Bible. So the Jews have also been, then that was the first exile. And later on they returned to their homeland. But of course there were other groups. There were other groups. There were the Philistines, with whom the Israelis fought. And recently I read something like Palestinians are a mixture of Philistines and some other people. In fact, an Arab scholar was doubting that the Palestinians are true Semites, that they are half, well, whatever, that's none of my business. But it goes back to explain, the issue I'm trying to explain here is that each of these people, or both of them, have as much claim to that land called, people call it Holy Land, or at one time it was Palestine, actually, during the, you know, that area has changed even hands so much. At one time, that area was under the Ottoman Turks Empire, up to around 1917, because the Ottoman Turks supported the Germans in the First World War. And as a result of that, that territory was taken from them and given to the British as a mandate. And so the British, when they took over that territory, they were confronted with demands by Jews to be settled. Like I said, okay, before that maybe, around 70 AD, the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed. The Romans took over and killed a lot of Jews who were dispersed all over Europe. And these came to be called the Jews in the diaspora. That word has now come to mean people are scattered and have left their home. And so the Jews were everywhere in Europe, mainly Russia, even Yemen. Hmm. Even Yemen, there were a lot of Jews in Yemen. Hmm. Which other one?
Germany.
Of course, Russia, Germany, then the other side in Yemen. Some were even a few in the UK. And later on, when the US became an independent state, some moved there. So, and yet, still, some few Jews remained in that land, which was then called Palestine.
Mm.
In fact, even today, interestingly, Israel has only about 40% of the Jewish population. The majority are outside Israel. So, as it is, the Jews are all over.
And well, let me just cut you short so that we can put this into perspective of what is happening now. Because in 1948, the Jews were resettled into present-day Israel, where there had been Arabs and Jews, Christians, and it was known as the Palestinians. Mm. Just briefly from the history that you have been mentioning there. And it is from here that we see wars of this particular area, because the Palestinians then settled in Gaza and the West Bank. And that is where the current fight is happening now, in Gaza and around the areas of Gaza. And Hamas, having gone into leadership in Gaza in 2006, is the one that actually first fired missiles into Israel, had an attack by land, by air, and by sea on Israel, October 7th. And this attack is the one that has triggered the current scenes that we are hearing or seeing that are being witnessed as we see them, the Hamas taking hostages of Israelis, and then Israel doing land operations on Hamas in Gaza. And yet Israel already controls the movements and access to that region. So what does Hamas want from Israel, and where is this headed to? What is Israel hoping to achieve in what they are doing right now?
Well, Vivian, to understand the current conflict, you still need to go back to know that in modern times, after the establishment of the Israeli state, 1948, like you say, 14th May 1948, there were many wars fought between the Israelis and the Arabs.
Including because the Nakba, which is the main one.
That one of, yes, that was the War of Independence then, yes. 1947-48. Then there was the Suez Canal War, where Egypt nationalized the Suez Canal and even bombed Israel. Now, the Suez Canal was under the control of the French and the British. And jointly, in collaboration with Israel, they defeated Egypt in that 1956 war. But then the scars of the war remained. And then we had the famous, or infamous, I don't know, whichever way you look at it, 1967 war, the Six-Day War, where Israel decisively defeated the Arab countries. It was a combination of all the Arab countries that you know. Jordan, Syria, Iraq, of course the biggest Arab country is Egypt. All of them, even Libya I think participated. All of them came together to fight and thoroughly defeat and destroy Israel. But Israel managed to defeat that combination of all these Arab states. Well, of course, Israel has got one most reliable ally, and that's the United States of America. And it's a historical fact that when the state of Israel was established, the first country to recognize Israel, it's on record, was the USA. The British were a bit cagey. They did not actually, even initially, the British did not want the Israelis to go back to Palestine. They made attempts to divert them from Palestine. One of those attempts was to suggest Uganda as a place where the Jews could settle in the 1920s. The Jews bluntly rejected that, saying Uganda was not in the Bible, and their homeland is well stated in the Bible as being that land in the Middle East, which one time was Judea or Palestine. And they would not, under any circumstances, go to any other land. And so, because the British were a bit cagey, in 1947, just when the British was about to hand over that territory to grant it independence, the British proposed a two-state solution, actually. A Palestinian state or Arab, and then a Jewish state. But the Jews had been, especially from the diaspora, had already started infiltrating that area, and they had fighters in there. And they managed, they fought that their way into independence. And they declared their independence, and like we said, in 1948, 14th May, and they got the state of Israel. And then the Arab nations decided to fight them. unsuccessfully, though. So, the issue of Israel in the area of Palestine, like we said, it really it's not, because there have been a lot of diversions about it. It has even caused a lot of divisive tendencies within even Africa, where you have the Christians mainly supporting Israel and the Muslims supporting the Palestine. But these people are not fighting about religion. I don't think so. Because the Jews or Judaism, Christianity and Islam are the three religions which they call those which stem from Abraham. But they are not fighting about faith.
Uh-huh. That's a very interesting take, because you just explained to us how the Jews are descendants of Abraham, and you also told us about the Ishmaelites from also Abraham. So the major war going on religious lines is about these alignments of Christians. For Abraham, in terms of Isaac and then Ishmael.
Yes, but outside
the Middle East. Let's bring it to what is happening now. And what effect will this war have on the affairs or politics of the Middle East?
Yes, yes. Well, the politics of the Middle East has always been all about Arab-Israel relations. At one time, there was no Arab nation with having diplomatic relations with Israel. Then in 1978-79, Egypt, which is the strongest Arab country, and which is the one which bore the brunt of the Israeli-Arab war, decided to make a peace deal with Israel, which was brokered by the then US President, Jimmy Carter, and then the Jewish Prime Minister then, Menachem Begin, and the Egyptian President Anwar Sadat signed that peace deal in January, I think, 1979. And then diplomatic relations were established between Israel and Egypt. And for a moment, there was some relative peace because Egypt stopped fighting Israel. And even today, Egypt is not participating in this war, but rather is acting as a kind of mediator. And then it's interesting to note that Egypt has even refused Palestinians to cross into their territory, which is interesting. One would have expected Palestinians to cross to Egypt, running from the fighting, but Egypt has blocked. We saw Ukrainians running to Poland, running to other neighboring European countries when there was fighting in their country, but not so in the Arab countries. Egypt has said, no, don't come. Even Jordan, which has Hezbollah, has not let Palestinians go into Jordan. Now the question is why? Well, I think I can try a guess here. Egypt has suffered a few things. No, Hamas, by the way, maybe you may not know, Hamas is called Islamic Revolutionary Movement. That's the meaning of Hamas. Islamic Revolutionary Movement. And Egypt has something against anything Islamic. Because in Egypt, there's the Islamic Front, which has been disturbing the Egyptian state for a very long time. In fact, as we speak even today, there is constant war in the Sinai Peninsula between the Egyptian armed forces and the Muslim fundamentalists. And so, because Hamas smells of Islamic fundamentalism, Egypt will never have them. And they can never be sure.
And you know, Hamas has been considered a terrorist group by the US and countries like the UK because they are said to use barbaric styles of fighting. So
barbaric, I don't know. Well,
to those that
terrorist methods.
Yes, terrorist methods. Yes.
And you know, the moment you are seen to be terrorist, then you have put off Egypt. Because Egypt is one country which has suffered a lot under terrorism. And they are very intolerant of anything that smacks of Islamic extremism.
Mm.
True, Egypt is predominantly a Muslim country.
Muslim nation.
But they will not tolerate extremism. And that's why they do not take kindly to Hamas and Hezbollah. You see, and this is where now we go back to what I was saying. Here, when you look at Africa, in general, really, even Uganda included, where they try to look at this war in terms of Christian and Muslim, where Christians support Israel and then Muslims support Palestine. And then, interestingly, recently, one of the hospitals which was bombed in Gaza Strip, that hospital was a Christian hospital. Actually, it belonged to the Anglican Church. Palestine, Bethlehem itself is in Palestine. And Bethlehem is the main, that's where Jesus was born. And it is not in Israel, it is in Palestine.
Mm.
And there are Christians in Palestine. And I might say there's more tolerance for Christians in Palestine than in Israel.
Very interesting. Because talking about that Christianity and the Arab dimensions to this particular conflict, how does what is going on currently in Gaza affect the geopolitics of how we see sympathy now being showed to Palestinians? Yesterday there was news coming through where in a Russian airport, there were a group or crowds of people who were waving Palestinian flags against those who had just landed at the airport, and they were doing it in support of Palestine. So we see a lot of sympathy going on around the world for Palestine.
Yes.
Because of what they are going through right now. And we have always known that Israel has also attracted a lot of sympathy because of what happened during the Holocaust,
where they lost about
6 million Jews.
That's true.
Yes.
Well, the number of Jews who died in the Holocaust is debatable, but whatever it was, even if they were only hundreds of thousands, still that was a lot. Already you can see that the people who have died in this conflict, by estimations, about 8,000 Palestinians and 1,400 Israelis who died during that attack. You can see how much it has caused an uproar. So the killing of Jews during the Second World War, that Holocaust by Hitler and his henchmen, was really very horrifying, very horrifying. And that is why Israel got a lot of sympathy. I mean, the best example is our own neighborhood here, how Rwanda received a lot of sympathy after the genocide of 1994. I'm sure even today Rwanda is still living on that sympathy, because people feel these fellows had been subjected to a lot of torture.
And violence.
And genocide.
And violence.
And so it is human nature to feel sympathy for people who have been victims of all manner of human rights violations. And then also we need to understand. To me, I'm not one of those who take sides in conflicts like this. Because basically, there's another issue. Maybe you haven't asked about it. Who owns this land? Like I started by saying, I believe both claim this land. And my own view is, if today Hamas had the upper hand, no Jew would be left in that Middle East area. I'm sorry to say it. They would kick them out.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure. They would kick them out. So this is a very historical issue where Each one of them feels they have the right ownership. And these are two intolerant people who will always aim to take an advantage wherever they can get it. Well, now what is Israel's advantage today? Israel, of course, has the support of the United States, which is the most powerful nation.
And why does the USA give blind support to the Israelites?
No, it's not blind. It's calculated, it's deliberate support. Why? Among the people who fought for America's war of independence, there were Jews. And when you look at the American flag, the Star-Spangled Banner, it resembles the Israeli flag. So it's not accidental, it's a historical issue.
Mm-hmm.
America and Israel, or at least Jews, have had that alliance lasting a long time. You know, it's very interesting, people may not know it now, that the people who supported the Americans during their War of Independence, of course the War of Independence was against the British, but the people who supported the Americans, one of those states was France. France supported the Americans against England or Britain, for obvious reasons, power struggle. And then the people within the US who supported this independence struggle were mainly a great number of the Jews. And even today, the Jews have got a sizable population in the US. And the Jewish lobby in the US is the strongest. That is why the U.S. will always support Israel. The Jews may not hold powerful positions in government, but they are very influential. Question is why? They are great inventors in terms of science, technology, modern IT and so on. That is one, great inventors. Two, they are great entrepreneurs. Business people, you know, great commerce people. The Jews have been great in the field of trade and commerce.
Mm.
And they are rich, of course.
And those are known to be very learned. But just away from that, let's talk about Russia and Russia's position. There are reports that Russia supports Hamas. We talked briefly earlier about it. But is this possible?
Maybe. Political support, yes. Material support, I'm not so sure. But what I know for a fact, during the earlier wars, especially between the Arab states and Israel, the Six-Day War, and Yom Kippur, which was 1973, Russia, or the Soviet Union, was on the side of Egypt, Syria, and the Allies. The reason was not that they loved the Arab countries so much. The reason was mainly power and ideological. Mm. That was the time of the Cold War. So if the U.S. went left, Russia would go right. And so since the U.S. was supporting Israel, Russia supported Egypt and the Arab nations. And perhaps this is one of the reasons why the Arabs lost the war, because the Soviet Union had a lot of Jewish infiltration. A lot of Jewish infiltration, which in a way enabled a lot of loopholes and leakages to get to Israel. And that is one of those issues which enabled Israel to win the war. When it comes to today, yes, I think Russia may support Hamas. But then remember, Russia also has got its own problems with terrorism. And that's what undermines Hamas's case. Because they use terrorist methods, even those who would find sympathy for them still feel, these people, you cannot take them all through for granted. All of us.
They could turn against us.
It's everywhere where terrorism is concerned. Uganda, we have a problem of ADF, who are terrorists even now. The other day, I think a few 2 days ago, they burnt another vehicle in Mpondo, somewhere near but in DRC, across the border. So a country like Uganda will be torn between sympathy for people who are dying. Really, it is terrible.
Yeah, very
Vivian,
terrible.
When you look at those pictures, they are so sad. Innocent people, these body bags, when you see them, women, children, it is so sad. And
well,
of course,
Israel
it is
has
not
also
one way
said that this Hamas uses human shields,
yes,
referring to one of those tales that they quote barbaric methods, where they will go and station on top of a hospital so that if you were hitting them, then you would be hitting a hospital. And I think those are some of the methods that you're talking about. We are going for a short break, and when we return, we will tell you more about the Israel-Gaza war. Hello, welcome back to The Checkpoint with me, Vivian Kamsimi. I am with retired Major David Rusa, an international scholar, and he is talking to us about the Israel-Gaza war and how the current scenes of hostages, people being killed in strikes, attacks. Israel is having a land operation there after the 7th October attack on them, and what all this means for the geopolitics.
Now, well, before we even go to geopolitics,
yes,
let's look at these two groups of people, the Israelis and the Arabs. They are people, even their, by their faith, religious-wise. See, Israelis, like I said, are not Christians. Christians, Jesus said, when somebody slaps you one cheek, you turn the other cheek. Not so the Jews. Jew will not turn the other cheek. He will go all out for revenge. The Hammurabi law, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. Similarly, the Arabs. And so where you have these two groups of radicals clashing at war, you can imagine how bloody the war will be. Actually, it's as if these people have got what they call the proportionality of numbers. Hmm. That for the Jews, if you kill a Jew, if you kill some Jews, they will make sure they outkill you, if I can use that word. They will kill more of you. Because one, Israel is surrounded by hostile neighbors who are more in number, almost 20 times.
Like Gaza has about
2 million, and yet it is a very small area.
People.
But now you consider
what a population.
Lebanon. Mm. Consider Iran is also in the periphery. You consider Iraq, although it's a bit, it is disorganized now. So Israel looks at all that as a hostile environment. And that is why, what makes Israel strong? Like, I think that's what we were talking about before. We broke off.
But just as we get into what makes Israel strong, does all this have an effect on the internal politics in Israel?
Very much so. Very much it does. And maybe let's look at what makes Israel strong. We can look at the internal politics also and what brought about this intelligence failure,
yes,
in my view.
Yes.
You see, Israel is supported by the strongest power, the United States. That is one. But number two, because of the US and because the Jews are great inventors and innovators, Israel has developed very heavy, has developed very advanced technology. In fact, it is one of the greatest.
The Iron Dome?
Iron Dome, of course, is just a protection dome.
Yes.
But even technologies, technologically.
Technologies within their intelligence organization.
Yes. But even technology for everyday things.
Mm.
You know, it, although it is not said, Israel, I'm very sure, has a nuclear weapon. Israel make their own aircraft, both for military and civil purposes. Israel has developed all types of technological advancements, computer, name it. And now, so when you add that they have the strongest power supporting them, and they are also technological and industrially advanced, then you can see what makes them strong and big. But they have also begun to relax. And this is what Hamas took advantage of. Remember, prior to that attack, there had been constant demonstrations about constitution, about, you know, you remember, you must
within have, Israel, within because Israel has yes. changed to over six prime ministers
yes.
in about two yes. years.
And that, you see, change of leadership in a country which is volatile or unstable affects the overall performance of that state. Because now Benjamin,
so it affects the leadership.
The leadership and
the
even
the general within the country.
Yes, and even the general politics. Because one leader has a different style, another one comes, there's even a leader they were trying of corruption. So when you all these things
that is
come,
Benjamin Netanyahu himself.
No, even the other one, the previous one. So when all these things come in, the state now, people get distracted or diverted. From, you know, because Israel has been surviving mainly, their priority number one is always security.
The threat to the existence of
that Israel. Mm. Yes. This, anything which they perceive to be a threat to the existence of Israel is dealt with very
decisively
fast
and fast.
Decisively, fast and ruthlessly. But now when they got diverted with legal hurdles, politics.
With reforms on the justice system,
so you can
by
see
the Prime
that,
Minister.
This has in a way affected their overall vigilance. Mm. And no wonder Hamas studied the barometer, took advantage, and they infiltrated. It is so surprising that Israel, which is reputed to have one of the best intelligence agencies in the world, the Mossad, could be infiltrated. And
actually, some experts say that the way Hamas was able to strike Israel this time around is the surprise that everyone is wondering what kind of skill that they used to be able to beat Israeli intelligence.
Yes, that's true. That's true. In fact, it's a great commendation to Hamas for having been able to remain concealed and attack at the right time and hit whatever they thought were the right target, and even take hostage over 200 people, some of whom were soldiers. That was great.
And well, you know, they attacked by land, by sea, by
yes,
air.
Yes, and it was multi-pronged attack, as you say, by land, by air, by sea. And then, perhaps me, what I think where Hamas erred was to kill innocent people. If Hamas had confined their killing to soldiers and only captured civilians as captives or hostages, the whole world would have greatly, greatly sympathized with Hamas.
Does this leave Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu weaker or stronger?
I think it leaves him bruised. It leaves him bruised. He will have to account, by the way. He will have, after the war, he will have to account. You see, those countries which have attained a high level of political culture, and Israel is one of them, they do not act out of impulse. They had to decide on what was a priority, and that was the defense of Israel. That is why they have left Netanyahu and his cabinet and everybody and allowed them to form a war cabinet, and they have put aside the whys. Why, how, they have put them aside now. The one issue at hand, defense of the motherland.
Okay. Also, reports have said that there's going to be an investigation on why the intelligence failed. And in fact, it was reported that Benjamin Netanyahu, the Prime Minister, had posted on social media blaming the intelligence commandos about the failure. And then he retreated with an apology, which is very rare of him, considering the kind of strong leader that he is known to be. And this can clearly be explained by what you just said when he was backing off, blaming the intelligence commandos, because at the end of the day, there's going to be an investigation and everyone will have to account for their part.
Everyone will have to account. Netanyahu himself, since he's an elected leader, he may have to pay through.
But politically. Through,
yeah, politically. Definitely, mm-hmm. definitely, definitely. But one other issue that led to this intelligence failure. You see, there has been a tendency to rely too much on what is called technical intelligence at the expense of human intelligence. And that is almost the same issue where the US, when they attacked Saddam Hussein, that was the same issue of relying too much on technical intelligence at the expense of human intelligence.
Hmm.
Machines are very good. We are using them now even. But machines have their own limitations. Machines don't feel. Machines are not maneuverable. They are rigid. They are only targeted to perform certain, like that
short,
dome you are talking about.
When you're talking about research by machine, then you're referring to quantitative information gathering versus qualitative
yes,
information.
Yes. Of course, machines are mainly quantitative.
Mm.
They will give you what you want. And machines are programmed to give you what you want. Of course, they had all these things, CCTV cameras, or these gadgets, surveillance gadgets. But then the Hamas now decided to go low. I'm told they went very deep underground where they could not be
detected.
And then they moved at a time when the Israelis were celebrating one of their holidays. People were enjoying themselves. And this is almost akin to what happened in 1973. This, what they call the, it is called what? Let me remember. It's called the, yes, Yom Kippur. The Yom Kippur, 1973 was similar, because even that time, Egypt managed to infiltrate, and actually it was a tough war. If the US did not bring additional reinforcement, maybe the Arab world would have thoroughly defeated Israel. But again, it came when they infiltrated during festivities, celebration. And this time, celebrations, coupled, of course, they were so much at peace, knowing that whatever comes, the machines will tell them. But then the machines could not detect anything.
Well, the Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has vowed to destroy Hamas completely. Is that possible?
It's not. It's not possible. It's not possible. Look at our own local example here.
Why?
We went out to destroy ADF, but have we destroyed them? Well, we have weakened them greatly, yes, but they are still there. You know, terrorism cannot be completely destroyed. They will be weakened. Maybe they will even lose the territory. Those areas, they are sanctuaries, they may lose them. But being destroyed thoroughly, it is not possible. You can never destroy terrorism thoroughly. You can never destroy a movement like this one. Only it will be really degraded, very highly degraded.
Weakened
to the extent that for some time they may not wage any infiltration or war or any terrorist activity. But they will raise up some time. They will again rear their head and do some fun activity. They could surprise you.
Well, where does this leave Russia, America, Britain, UK, in the geopolitics to do with Israel and Gaza?
I think the status quo is going to remain as it is. Because Israel is going to win the war. There's no doubt about that. Anyone who has qualms about that
is... What is winning that war? Because, you see, Israel already has leadership, or is the one that actually controls the access and movements within Gaza. In fact, some activists have called this an open prison that is going on in Gaza.
Yes.
So what is winning this war? What does that mean?
By winning, I mean for this battle, let's not call it a war, the battle. Mm. Israel is going to kill as many Hamas as possible, and also, sadly, as many innocent people as possible. But of course, you see, in all this, I see only one solution.
Mm.
We go back, that solution will be the two-state policy, the two-state solution, meaning there should be the Jewish state, which is Israel. But by the way, even Israel is not wholly a Jewish state, because the Jews in Israel constitute only 73%. There are also Arabs, which now you can see is 26%. No, 24% are Arabs.
Mm.
Okay? But now the solution should be having a state of people who call themselves Palestinians or Arabs, and then you have Israel, these two side by side as in sovereign states.
Mm.
But I do not think this will stop the war. There will always be skirmishes between the two.
Well, we see Israel defying international bodies such as the UN to stop humanitarian aid convoys that are getting in to help the people in Gaza as they face this war from Israel. Where does it get the courage to do this?
You know, simple. The UN, you know the UN system. The UN General Assembly makes a lot of resolutions. Okay, even before we answer that, where did Russia get the courage to defy the UN? Remember, the UN General Assembly voted overwhelmingly to condemn Russian invasion of Ukraine.
Mm.
But Russia continued and nothing. You see, the UN system is not a world government. It is an international organization, the most universal, and almost the UN operates on the willingness of members to abide by its directives, especially the powerful ones. You know, the UN has 5 permanent members.
The United Security Council.
Security Council, yes. The United States, Russia,
UK.
Russia
was kicked out after the invasion in Ukraine.
No. Russia can never be kicked out. So
so it is still a member on
yes,
that Security Council.
Yes, it is the USA, Russia, UK, France, and China.
Mm.
Those are the 5 permanent members of the UN Security Council.
And the rest of the nations have a rotational seat.
10 other nations have rotational seat on the UN Security Council.
Yes.
Now, when we are still talking about the UN Security Council, these 5 permanent members have got what we call a veto power.
Yes, that's right.
Which means that if any one of the 5 rejects a motion, that motion is automatically defeated.
And in fact, those veto powers were currently used by the US to revoke a motion that was condemning Israel's attack.
Exactly.
In defense.
Exactly.
Of the Hamas attack.
Israel will never be blamed as long as the US is a member of the UN Security Council.
Mm.
As long as Britain is a member of the UN Security Council. As long as France is a member of the UN Security Council. And then, of course, China sometimes may even abstain when they think something is controversial. So,
you're left with Russia.
Okay. But in any case, any one member equals the rest. In other words, refusal by one member is equal to refusal by all. Acceptance by one member is not the same. But refusal or veto negates everything.
Well, do you think the Palestine-Israel conflict will ever be resolved in some way?
It will only be resolved once there are two states, a Palestinian state. Partially. It will be only partially resolved, not fully. It will be partially resolved when there's a Palestinian state and an Israeli state. But of course, there will be other challenges. How do you decide the boundaries? What happened to Jerusalem, which is being contested? How does Israel ensure that its enemies do not infiltrate from Palestine, especially? Now today, the most controversial enemy of Israel is Iran. Because Iran, unlike these other countries, vows destruction of Israel. See, so that makes the situation very complicated. Because you think Israel will accept to be destroyed by Iran? Answer is obviously
not.
No. So maybe Iran also must be brought to book and told that stop this talk of destruction of Israel. Let's work for formation of two states, Israel and Palestine, which respect each other, which establish diplomatic relations, which not engage in any more wars. But of course, as long as there are these people who fund the war, outsiders especially, because this in a way is a proxy war.
Who is funding this war?
The powers that are. Like you hear Iran, the US, of course. The US has
funding Israel.
Has interest in the Middle East and it's backing Israel. Iran is on the other side. Let's even say Russia is also partly
for Hamas.
For the Arabs. So as long as there are these who have turned the Middle East into a place of proxy wars, the situation will continue. It has been there, it's as long, like I said, it's a very old conflict, and as long as there are people who fan the fire, as long as there are people who continue, I'm sure, well, I might be wrong, but I'm very sure Iran wants to use Hamas almost as shield to fight Israel. And why does Iran hate Israel, by the way? Don't think it's religious. Forget about this. None of these people is religious, apparently. It is interests. It's interests.
What interests?
Iran has been trying to develop a nuclear weapon. And the US is a bit far. But the one state which is a stumbling block or an obstacle to Iran in the whole Middle East is Israel. See?
And Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in the past has been all over the countries that were in negotiations with Iran about the Iranian nuclear deal.
Yes, and you can see Saudi Arabia and Israel are about to establish, if it was not for this war. In fact, some conspiracy theorists say Iran might have funded this war to prevent Israel and Saudi Arabia establishing diplomatic relations. That's a conspiracy theory. I'm not saying it's true, but it's there. And so, you see, in that Middle East now, I think Iran has replaced Egypt as the most powerful state. And of course, when you try to be a powerful state in the Middle East, you can bet you are provoking the wrath of the United States. And more so when it is Iran. Because the US and Iran have had their own contradictions stretching back to 1979, when the then Shah of Iran, or the king, was overthrown by Islamic revolutionists led by Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini. And then Iran took American diplomats hostage in Tehran for over 1 year, 2 years, I think. So, and that is, it has never happened again. It had never happened before, and it has not happened since, where a country takes hostage diplomats of another, and not only another country, but the most powerful country.
And Iran is former Persia. We have read all this history about yes. the strength of Persia.
Yes, those Persians, that's true.
Yes. As we conclude this, Gaza is a very small strip of land, surely, just about 41 kilometers long and 6 to 12 kilometers wide.
Yes.
Honestly speaking, what do you think can actually end this conflict for such a small piece of land?
Well, as a Christian, I would say if people get saved, if people begin to look at one another as brothers, of course, this is the hypothetical bit. Now, the practical bit is that what will reduce this conflict is one, respect for one another. Let the Palestinians respect the Jews or the Israelis as a state, and let them agree to say, let's live and let live, not live and let die. And then also, some of these other powers, which are funding those kinds of, like Iran, even the United States itself, should stop meddling. But are they going to stop it? Obviously not. So, this conflict, to me, is going to take a long time to end. But if the two parties can accept and recognize that they have to live side by side, like, by the way, Mahmoud Abbas, the leader of Palestine, of Fatah, had tried to come together and say, okay, let's discuss with Israel. But before that could happen, Hamas came in.
Well, our very own President Yoweri Museveni sent condolence messages, a condolence message on X when Israel was attacked on 7th October, and he suggested a two-state solution. And I guess that's what you're talking about.
Yes.
That has been this week's Checkpoint. Until next week, I am Vivian Kansimi.